Is a place where you promise to be. I'm not enough.
Back line.
Unless you come, we need me here again. 'Cause all I want is all you are. We can meet me here again.
Well, good morning, Evanston Vineyard. Good morning. We are so glad you are here this morning. It's been about 6 months, way too long to be together. So we welcome you to our service today. We welcome all those who are watching on our live stream at home. Welcome to you as well. Thank you for practicing the social distancing this morning. You are welcome to sing out as well. Just please keep your masks on throughout the entire service. But we're so glad you're here. I'm just going to begin with some prayer, and we're going to sing some songs to God together. Father, we thank you for today, God. We thank you for this opportunity to be together, God. We welcome your Holy Spirit right now, God. Just come and be among us, Lord. We love you. We honor you here today. We honor you here today, God. Have your way with us this morning, God. Have your way. Thank you for your love, God, that draws us, Lord. To sing, nothing can tear us. And nothing can tear us from the grip of his mighty love. We've only glimpsed his vast affection, heard whispers of his heart and passion, his pouring down.
love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it's furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to life. Father loves and sends His Son. Son lays down His life for all. He lavishes His love upon us. He calls us now His sons and daughters. His love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it's furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to alive. Sing that again, His love. His love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. His love is fierce, His love is strong, it's furious. His love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to life. He's 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 waking us to life. Love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. Love is fierce, His love is strong, it's furious. Love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to life. Love is deep, His love is wide, and it covers us. Love is fierce, His love is strong, it's furious. Love is sweet, His love is wild, and it's waking us to life. He's 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 waking us to life.
Let's sing that together, your love.
Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens.
me into the light. You call my name and then my heart came alive.
Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
Thank you for your love. Thank you for your love, God. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my dream, yeah. Till I met you.
Sing, you call my name.
You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day. You called my name, and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness, into your glorious day.
Sing, now your mercy.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know.
The old made new.
The old made new. Jesus and I.
Sing, I needed rescue.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. glorious day. You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. What a day, God, what a day.
Your spirit lives within me, so I will walk in your
Thank you, God. Thank you that you are a shepherd, Lord. Thank you, our strong tower we can run to in times of trouble. Thank you, God, we don't have to have fear. We can rest in you. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Feel free to take your seats. Thank you.
Good morning, Evanston Vineyard. How are you this morning? Oh, I'm so excited to see you. It has been a long, long time. So say hi. I want to say hi to all the kids out there. My name is Iris Anderson, and I'm the children's pastor here at the Evanston Vineyard. And I brought with me a special friend today, my friend Marco. Marco.
Am I late? I didn't miss it, did I? I'm so excited.
Marco,
Where is it?
Where's what?
The food. Didn't you say you wanted me to join you for a Thanksgiving dinner? All night I've been dreaming about turkeys and stuffing and mashed potatoes and gravy, buttered rolls and green bean casserole. I don't even like green bean casserole, but I can't stop dreaming about it.
Oh, Marco. Oh, my goodness, Marco. No, I didn't invite you here for Thanksgiving dinner. That's not till November.
What?
Yeah, let me take this off so you can hear me a little bit better. Oh. No, I invited you here to help me read the Thanksgivings.
Miss Iris, does that mean I am not getting sweet potato pie this morning? Because I haven't eaten in days. I'm ready to eat.
Oh, no, Marco, I'm sorry, but I think you're going to like this a lot better. Hmm. You see, this is a time that we come together as a church family and share in all of God's provisions and in all of his blessings in our lives. So our family and friends and our congregation have written in and sent us some of their thanksgivings during this season.
All right, so I guess you're saying we're going to read about all the things God has done, great and small, and then celebrate?
Yeah, exactly.
All right, Miss Iris, that does sound better than pie. I got to admit that. Let me take this turkey off then, off my head. I'll be right back.
Okay. While we wait for Marco, we like to join together as a church family and pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, which is the Lord's Prayer. So if you would join me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Oh,
Marco. Cyrus, I cannot wait to hear about all these things people are thankful for. Let's do it.
All right, here we go. Yeah. Brianna Silva writes, and she says, I'm thankful for the news earlier this week that my father's newly diagnosed cancer has not spread to other parts of his body. While he has a long road ahead, the prognosis is optimistic.
Right.
And Dave Kapoor says that he is thankful that he finished his nursing degree and passed the RN exam.
Nice.
Yeah. Michelle Mitchell writes, I'm thankful for recent doctor radiology reports that show no further growth of the metastatic breast cancer tumor in my lungs. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm going to read some. I want to look over there. So Josiah Cammy from eighth grade says,
yes,
he's thankful that God kept him on track this year and he's getting his work done. He's also thankful his cousin Mateo is well and out of the hospital. Yeah, I like that. That was pretty
good. Yeah.
Let's do another one. David Cammy from first grade says he is thankful for math. Hey, you know what? Me too. If it wasn't for math, we wouldn't have video games and like buildings and probably so many other things. Isn't that right, Miss Cyrus?
That is true. Okay, well, Liz Richardson writes, she's thankful that her aunt, who is sickly and on a ventilator due to COVID, was removed from the ventilator on her birthday.
Wow.
She's also thankful for Rob's new job starting next week, and she was able to get an MRI. Sayi writes, I'm thankful for the release from the hospital for my son's grandmother. Her testimony of how she knew Jesus had alleviated her pain and prayer, and the timeliness and the intervention at the hospital are a great testimony of answered prayer. May she continue to heal. And then on Friday, my grandmother's life, as well as many others, was spared when a helicopter crashed on the side of her home. My grandmother was inside in her home reading her Bible when this happened. She's going to be 90 in March.
Wow.
Yeah. Mary McKellick says, I'm thankful that God has provided a way for me to stay in Chicago after my school shut down its campus. He provided a job for me. I was able to continue to work when the rest of the world was closed. He's provided for me in the midst of this global crisis, and I have never gone without. I'm in awe of his goodness and his generosity.
All right. Sarah Cambron from fifth grade says she is thankful to God for her family and having a home. And Paulo and Lily Aracion from Limitless and VQ say they're thankful for our youth pastors during this time.
Yes.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah. John Adams shares
that. You know what, Miss Iris?
What?
You know what I'm thankful for?
No, what?
I'm thankful for our children's pastors, personally. Yeah, let's give a big hand for the children's
pastor. I think he's a little biased. Thank you. Adam shares that our daughter Erica graduated, praise God, and he adds that our son has agreed to allow his son and daughter-in-law to come and live with them in order for them to retire their college loans.
Right.
And Joyce and Stephen Hayworth write that they're thankful for God's protection as we clean out a house that has not been maintained well. They had a few near misses, including a ladder that hit Stephen in the face, but no serious injuries.
While Aurelie Givens-Belsley from seventh grade says she's thankful that online learning is going well and she got to spend time with her cousin last week. Hey. And her sister Elodie from second grade says she's thankful for puppies, piggies, and stuffed animals. Man, we're all pretty thankful for stuffed animals, right, Ms. Iris? Right? Are you right?
Yes, we are.
Yeah,
yes,
I threw out that children's pastor line for you. All right.
All right. Amanda Edsworth says that she's thankful for being able to buy a condo and modify it to suit her for the long term. And Bar Comp writes, she's thankful for just the sweet way that Jesus has of dealing with troubles and how he shows her his loving kindness in all ways.
All right. Hallis Kirsten from third grade says he's thankful for his mom for making him born.
I am too.
Yeah, and then his sister Nora from third grade also has one. I bet she's thankful that Hallis was born too. What do you think?
Yeah.
Oh, well, actually it says she's thankful for being 9 and the way God treats it. Well, that was pretty good too. That's a great one.
Hillary Wells Prang on Dan Wells says we're thankful for our yard and garden, which has given us space to get together with friends and family safely. And Ray and Edie Bianchi write, people who are in Evanston, Chicago, they're prayerful that they can pray for their daughter in Houston because God is not limited by time or distance. Hmm. And Sonia Lowe adds, I am thankful to the Lord for waking me up each day.
So am I. Oh, and also, Miss Iris, I think you missed one. There's one here on the ground over here.
What?
Yeah.
Oh.
This one down here says it's from Katie Lynacki, who's thankful that she got married recently. to a most amazing guy I hear. His name is David Anderson. He's so tall, and he's very nice and probably very handsome.
And I'm very thankful for that as well. I just recently became a mother-in-law, so thank you, Lord.
Wait, amen. You know this guy?
I do know this guy. So amen. We are so thankful for the Lord's faithfulness and for his care yeah. of us.
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Can you hear me? Do I have it on? Do I have it on or... You know, we like Marco so much that we've decided to hire him as a pastor in the church. Marco, thank you. Marco's gonna be preaching next Sunday. I'm just kidding. Hey, it's so good to see all of you. So good to see all of you. And I know that we are here and we're social distance and we're sitting far apart from each other, but I just want to invite you to all to stand up and give virtual hugs to the people near you. Can we do that? You stand up. I mean, no. You got to like, it's got to be reciprocated. You know, it can't just be like one person hugging another. You know, yeah, that's right. Wave at each other. Virtual hug one another. This is amazing. All right, you can be seated. We could do this all day long. You know, what I find, and yes, all right, like, yes. Like, if you want to throw kisses to each other, go ahead and do that. Welcome to you online as well. This is why the camera's there. Some of you weren't able to make it today, but we're so glad to be here together, gathered together. Isn't it sort of amazing that we're together? You know, isn't it kind of amazing? I don't know if you follow the news very much or you see what the church is doing all around the world, but somehow, even in this strange season, the church continues to meet, right? I mean, can you imagine if we had this happen to us 30 or 40 years ago and we didn't have the benefits of technology? God uses everything, and the church simply cannot be stopped. That's what the Apostle Paul says, actually, in Colossians 1. He says that the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world. And guess what, everyone? Nothing stops that, not even a pandemic, not even civil unrest. Nothing stops that. The gospel, the good news of Jesus, will continue to bear fruit until the end of time. That's what we've signed up for, folks. That's what we've signed up for. I was reading this story about this woman in the Philippines who basically gave her life to Jesus during the pandemic because she was on a website talking to some random person about fear in the time of coronavirus. I mean, the gospel is still bearing fruit, and it's no different here. We serve hundreds of people on Wednesdays, meet with hundreds more online, and there are a rash of new small groups this semester. The church, my friends, cannot be stopped. Jesus, of course, said this was going to be so, didn't he? He said that this was going to happen. Jesus said that the church, the communal expression of his kingdom, could never be stopped, not even by the powers of death and darkness. And that's what I want to talk about today. So if you've got your Bible with you or you've got your phone, would you open up your Bible or you open up your phone to Matthew chapter 16? Matthew chapter 16. Now, if you don't have your Bible, it's actually printed in the program, so you can open your program up and read and follow along with me here. So here's what's happening in Matthew chapter 16 before what we're about to read. This is shortly after the disciples feed 5,000 miraculously, and then in a maybe little less known event, feed 4,000 people, okay? And so this is what's happening right after that. And this is after basically the whole people are like, this guy can actually feed us out of nowhere. He's truly, truly, truly going to be our king. And so Jesus is with his disciples in verse 13, and he asks, who do people say I am? So the disciples basically say, well, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets. Inspired by the Holy Spirit, Peter answers differently when Jesus says, but what about you? Disciples, you've been with me. What about you? Who do you say I am? And so Peter answers, and I'm not even sure he knew what he was saying, but this is how he answers. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. Somehow, Peter recognizes that Jesus is the true king. Somehow, Peter recognizes that he's not just a prophet who's going to say to the people what the kingdom of God should be and what it's not right now. He's not just the mouthpiece of God, but he's actually the true king of the people of God, speaking to the powers of this day, but also ruling, eventually ruling, the government resting on his shoulder, the true promised son whom the Psalms and the prophets have spoken of. Peter recognizes somehow that Jesus is our Savior. And he recognizes that everyone in power, from Herod to Caesar to the Pharisees to the governments of this day, need to watch out. That's what Peter says. And listen to how Jesus responds to Peter's declaration. Jesus says, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Peter, through this declaration, through his allegiance, is Petros, is the rock, is the stone, the foundation, the beginning of the new people of God, the new church. Which makes me think of another time when the Lord renamed someone pivotal in the history of God. Anybody remember Abraham being renamed Abraham? Anybody remember that? Raise your hand if you remember that. Anybody remember when Jacob was renamed Israel? Anybody remember that? You know, whenever someone is renamed in the Bible, it usually means that person is going to be very, very, very important in the history of God. And here's the thing about this word Petros in the Greek, this word stone. I'd be hard-pressed to imagine that the disciples weren't thinking about something else Jesus said when Jesus calls Peter the rock. If you're familiar with just a few chapters before the Sermon on the Mount, you may recall that the way Jesus ends the Sermon on the Mount is like this. Therefore, this is what Jesus says at the end of his magnificent sermon toward the middle of the book of Matthew. Therefore, anyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on a, everybody say it together, rock. The same word he used to call Peter. Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rains came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the what? Rock. Yes, rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash. That's how Jesus ends his most famous sermon. He ends by talking about a rock. Fast forward to right now when he's talking to Peter, and he calls Peter the rock. Build your house on the rock. What rock? Jesus' words, of which Peter's declaration it might be the most important. Jesus is our Savior. He's our deliverer. He delivers us from death and darkness to make us his children. This declaration that Peter said when Jesus asked him, well, who do you say I am? This declaration, and therefore Jesus is the rock upon which your house must be built. And guess what? The church is the house built on the rock. That's what the church is. The church is the house built on the rock of the truth that Jesus saves us. That's what the church is. When Peter called, or when Jesus called Peter the rock, at least some of the disciples had to be thinking about that. They had to be thinking about, whoa, the rock Jesus talked about to end his sermon. And Peter is the rock because he's the first among us who recognized and articulated and declared the truth that Jesus is Lord. The first among us. So when the rain comes down, pandemic, when the streams rise, flooding. How many of you experienced a little flooding during this pandemic? Or a tornado touching down just a few blocks away. When the streams rise, when the winds of culture and change and persecution blow against the church, it's going to stand. The church is going to stand because it's the house built on the rock. And Jesus continues by saying, not even hell can stand up against the house built on the rock. He says next, the gates of Hades will not overcome the church. The gates of Hades, the powers of death, will not overcome the church. It will be living constantly in the resurrection power of Jesus. It will never, ever be overcome by death. It's a new community of the restored people of God, which will last forever. Death could not stop Jesus, and it's not going to stop us. In fact, there is story after story about missionaries who go onto the mission field, who have given their lives on the field, only for that field to bloom into a full gospel flower. Story after story. Tertullian famously said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. When the Vikings invaded England and ravaged the nuns and killed the monks and burned the monasteries, they were trying to kill the church. But 100 years later, guess what? The Vikings were all Christians. That's what happens. The gates of Hades cannot overcome the church. The church has got a pretty good defense. I'm going to wait. But it doesn't just have a defense. What Jesus also says to Peter, it doesn't have a defense. Not only does it have a defense against the gates of Hades, it has an offense too. And that's what this next part is about. This is what Jesus says next to Peter. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. When we think about keys, we think about locks, don't we? We think about keys, we think about locks. And what do we lock up? We lock up things that are valuable to us, don't we? But come on, let's think about this. This is keys to the kingdom of heaven. In other words, this is keys to the most immeasurable, unmeasurable treasure and riches that this universe has ever experienced. He's giving you and me those keys. He's not just giving them to Peter. And you know how I know he's not just giving them to Peter? Because in a couple chapters later, he basically says, the same stuff I'm giving to Peter, I'm giving to you too. In Matthew 18, he says, truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This is just two chapters after he tells this thing to Peter. So it's you and me. We got those keys too. And you know, the interesting thing about the context of those verses in Matthew 18 is that it's about correction, about sin and forgiveness, which gives us a clue as to what Jesus is talking about when he's talking to Peter. We have the keys to the kingdom of heaven because we have the secret of the kingdom. We have the treasure of the kingdom that each one of us can be forgiven because of the saving work of Jesus, that mercy and grace are freely ours because of Jesus. That's the treasure of the kingdom. That's the secret of the kingdom, that grace and mercy are the way this kingdom is ruled, that we can all have peace with God no matter who we are or what we've done. And let me tell you that that kind of mercy and grace, that's what true power looks like. That's true power, because it can turn the world completely upside down. Listen, think about this. Every single person who's experienced some kind of grace has been shocked, haven't they? I remember experiencing grace and mercy. I remember receiving that grace for the first time. I remember receiving the free forgiveness of a brother, even though I didn't deserve it. And it hit me like lightning. Because the world does not work this way, does it? The world doesn't work this way. Everything has a price in our world. But in the economy of the kingdom of God, that price is paid by Jesus. And mercy and grace and forgiveness are freely yours and mine. That's what those keys are for, the secret of the kingdom. So in one hand, we have the gospel of grace. But in the other hand, we hold the hand of the Spirit who leads us and who is passionate for the unleashing of God's mercy and freedom on the world. He gave us keys not just to the secret of the kingdom, but also to the unleashing of the Spirit. The other secret of the kingdom is that when Jesus came, we didn't just receive mercy and grace, did we? What happens when Jesus is raised from the dead and he sees the disciples? Does anybody know? Well, he tells them, he shows them his hands and his side, but then he breathes on them and he says, receive the Holy Spirit. Receive the Holy Spirit. He gave us a spirit that would enable us to do greater things than the world saw when Jesus was on earth. He gave us a spirit that would fire up our bones so that we would not live in fear, but we would live in boldness, self-control, and in love. He gave us power. He gave us power. He gave us an offense. He gave us keys to the unleashing, not just of the secret of the kingdom, but also to the power of the Spirit. Some years ago, I was praying for a woman, and this woman stayed after one of our prayer meetings and asked, can you pray for me? And so me and this other person, we started praying for her. And as soon as we started praying, her face started to contort and look disturbed and look in pain. So I knew that at that point in her life, there was some other kind of power in her life and not just Jesus. So I prayed. And the other person with me prayed. And we kept on praying. And we kept on praying, but she didn't feel any better. Finally, I just began to read scripture to her. I began to read the Bible to her. I just read it over and over again. And everywhere it said you, I put her name. And after reading it a few times, her face started to change. She started to blow out rapidly. If you've ever been in a situation like this, you probably know what I'm talking about. I think she may have even burped, and then all of a sudden became peaceful. Power. There was power there. I was binding the powers of the underworld because I had the keys to the kingdom, because I believe in Jesus as you and I do. We have keys, and that gives us power. That gives us power to proclaim the good news of Jesus, and also gives us power to bind the powers of the underworld. And guess what I was reading when I read scripture over her? I was reading about grace and mercy. Ephesians chapter 1. So in one hand, we have the gospel of grace. In the other hand, our keys, we can unleash the magnificent freedom of the Spirit. So I ask you, what can stop the church? The house built on the rock. Not death, because killing our king didn't work. Not legalism, not religion, not persecution, not martyrdom, not governments hell-bent on destruction, not even a global pandemic. Nothing can stop the church. Jesus said so, and he's been right for about 2,000 years. He'll be right till the end of time. That's why we're here, isn't it? That's why we're here. So as we close, I want to do three things. The first thing that I want to do is I want to remind us of what is still possible during this pandemic as a church. We can still pray for one another, can't we? We can still serve our community, can't we? We can still have church through the wonders of technology, can't we? And through the wonders of being able to sit in a parking lot. I mean, how many of you are thankful that we haven't had anybody show up and say, what are you guys doing right now? And we're like, well, we're just, you know, singing with our friends and and worshiping Jesus. I mean, nothing is going to stop the church. And we can still actually meet together, maybe not as a large group like this, but definitely, definitely, definitely as small groups. Our VQ, our high school group is meeting. Our Limitless, our middle schools are meeting. Things are going to happen for our kids in small groups. Dozens of small groups are going to be meeting this fall. We've got in-person groups. We've got Zoom groups. We have hybrid groups. We have groups that are outside. We have groups that are inside. And so if you haven't signed up for a small group, can I encourage you to do that? I mean, we're going to live like the early church lived and meet together in smaller groups. And we're going to do that this fall. And I would love, love, love for you to come and love for you to sign up. But the other thing that I want to do today, the second thing that I want to do today, is I don't want to leave this space without taking a moment to remind or recognize that in this strange, strange season, we probably have all experienced some kind of loss. Some of us are mourning the loss of things that everyone normally gets to experience. Some of us are mourning the loss of certain rites of passages like graduation, or proms, or some of us have gotten married during the pandemic. Marco got married during the pandemic, for those of you who didn't know. He actually got married during the pandemic. Anyway, some of us have gotten married during the pandemic, and it's different. Even though we can celebrate, it's still different. In some ways, it feels like loss. Some of us have lost loved ones. COVID has stolen the life of some of our dearest friends and family, dearest relatives, and not just COVID, others have experienced loss as well. All of us, in the very least, have lost the human contact that we desperately need. We are made to be together. And somehow in COVID, it changes the reality of that. And so I want to do one thing before we take communion. What I'd like us to do is I'd like us to take out our phones, or take our programs. There's space underneath today's message, this space in our program. And I'd like to take a moment to write down at least some of the things that we've lost in this strange season. Just take a moment and write it down. Because what I want us to do with that, after we write that down, I'd like us to offer it to Jesus and to say, here, Jesus, is my loss and disappointment. I offer it to you. Take it from me. I'd like for us to do that. So can we just take a moment, take out your phones, take out a piece of paper, and just take a moment just to write something down. Write some loss that you've experienced during COVID. Just take a moment right now. Yeah, just take out your phones. If you've got your phone with you, just even a small note. What have you lost in this particular season? Then what I'd like us to do after we do that, is offer it to Jesus. Okay, let's just take 10 seconds and do that. Write down a couple things. That's right. Thank you for participating. Yeah, wherever you're at, doesn't have to be much. Just write down something. All right, let's bow our heads for a moment, and let's take that piece of paper that we have, or that document in our phone, and we're gonna, like, actually there are trash cans in the back. Take that document and put it in the trash as you walk out, or take that document on your phone and just trash it on your phone if you know how to do that. But before you do that, just let's bow our heads and let's offer it to Jesus. Would you pray with me? We recognize, Jesus, in this season, we have experienced loss. Here are our losses. We give them to you. Take them from us. We cast them before you. Bearer of all of our burdens, Jesus, we give them to you. Amen. Amen. Man, 2020 is... How many of you want to just, like, flip the calendar? Let's get to 2021 already. I don't know if you feel that way. But 2020 is a storm unlike no other. It's exactly what Jesus said would happen. The rains would come down, the streams would rise, and the winds would blow and beat against the house. But let me tell you, as we are gathered here and even online, we are part of a house that is built on a rock that will stand. We are part of the global church that is built upon a rock that will stand, and there is no stream or no wind or nothing that can stop it. And it's true, and it has been true for 2,000 years. It will be true until the end of time. This, my friends, is the beloved eternal community. And so, as we close, I would like to close by inviting us all to lean into the truth that Jesus is our Savior, the Son of the living God, and our salvation by us taking communion together. All right, so hopefully you all got elements as you came in. So let's all take those elements out. We're going to do this a little bit differently. Unlike how we normally take communion, this time we're going to do it in a specific order. And we're going to do it all together, all right? So everyone lift the cover off of the wafer and hold that wafer. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Everyone, let's take, eat. And now let's lift the cover off of the juice. After supper, he took wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. When you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." I'm going to invite you to drink. Let's all drink. I'm going to invite Chris and Stephanie to come on up, but let's pray. Let's all bow our heads and pray for a moment. Magnificent, beautiful, loving Savior Jesus, our Messiah, Son of the living God, thank you for your grace and your mercy and your forgiveness. Thank you for your power. Thank you that your house will always stand. Cover us, sustain us. We receive your forgiveness. And we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey everyone, I'm Chris Herning, the high school pastor.
And I'm Stephanie, the middle school pastor.
And thanks so much for joining us today, online or in person. It's so good to see you guys.
We are going to close in just a minute, but first we want to share a couple of important announcements with you. If you are on the prayer team, you can start coming forwards right over there right now.
We have many other things happening within our church community throughout the week, and the best way to stay informed and get involved is to subscribe to our weekly email update by clicking on the subscribe button on our website.
And we would love to hear from you this morning. You can fill out a connect card online on our website, or if you're watching online, click connect in the chat feed.
So those connect cards help us to hear from you. There's a space for questions, comments, and prayer requests, and even to put in a spot for what you're thankful for. And we actually read through those and pray for them every week.
And if you have taken the first step of following Jesus recently, let us know. We want to know. Maybe you made that decision last Sunday, during the week, or even this morning. Even if you are home alone right now, deciding to follow Jesus brings you here, connected to all of us, the family of God. We want to hear your story and celebrate that decision with you.
We also want to take our offering this morning. Here at the Vineyard, we believe that we are the church, and we do lots of ministry together as a church, and part of what makes that possible is our generous giving.
For those of you who give regularly, thank you. For those who haven't yet set up a digital recurring gift, we've made it really easy for you. In the chat, you can click give right now or any week online, or just go to our website. It's very easy to sign up.
So thanks for joining us today. We're so glad you came, except for the bees. We're not thankful for you, but that's okay. We're going to stick around for a little bit after the circus.
Service.
After the service so we can connect. But remember, try to keep 6 feet apart and your masks on so we can enjoy the day safely. Please stay in your seat for a little bit after the service is over because we're going to dismiss you by rows. If you'd like prayer, though, you can come to the front to have a member of our prayer team.
See Brian? Go to Brian.
Yeah. Pray for you when your row is dismissed. Or if you're watching online, you can click the prayer request button online.
And just to set your mind at ease, we will continue to follow social distancing during prayer. No laying on of hands or any of that. But come and get some prayer. Okay, let's close our eyes. I am going to pray a benediction over us from Numbers 6. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. We will see you online next Sunday. Go out and be the church.